acari or ticks and mites do not have a definite head region. That is why they are also called as acari. And it was Aristotle who used the term acari first. And further, in Old English, the word mite means very small. And this word came into popular during 1650s. So what is the significance of acari? And you know, like insects, they are also one of the largest group of arthropods. Acari is particularly among the group Arachnida. Okay, the class Arachnida includes a subclass Acari as well as 10 other subclasses. Among the class Arachnida, it is the subclass Acari which is the largest subclass and which is the more diverse. So it is more significant. This group is very significant because of its diversity itself. Let us look into the systematic position of Acari. You know, Acari or mites and ticks, they belong to the phylum Arthropoda like our insects itself. And the subphylum Chelicerata, see here, what is the subphylum to which insects belong to? Anybody, please unmute and can tell me the answer. Tell me the subphylum to which insects belong. Anybody? Anybody can answer? Can you hear me? Please answer. It is Mandibulata. Okay, it is Mandibulata, subphylum Mandibulata to which insects belong. Whereas ticks and mites and all arachnids, they belong to the subphylum Chelicerata. What again is the difference between Mandibulata and Chelicerata? If I remember correct, I had taught you in the first entomology course. Chelicerata, the word Chelicera, that is a type of mouthpart in Arachnida, including mites and ticks. Whereas mandibles, insects have basically, there is a lot of the modifications in the basic type, but still they have mandibulate type of mouthpart. Okay. And so the systematic position is phylum Arthropoda, subphylum Chelicerata, class Arachnida, subclass Acari. And you know, as I said, class Arachnida includes 11 subclasses, of which the subclass Araneae, which includes spiders, as well as subclass Acari, which includes ticks and mites, are very distinct from other 9 subclasses in that their body segmentation, somatic segmentation or body segmentation, is very inconspicuous or even absent. If you take a spider, and because spiders are big enough, whereas ticks and mites are small, so that you may not be able to distinguish their body region. So if the naked eye. So in spider, if you look at the anterior portion of the body, which is called as cephalothorax, then the posterior portion of the body, which is abdomen, you don't find segmentation in that region like in insects. Similarly, in ticks and mites also, the anterior portion and the posterior region of the body will not have distinct segmentation. So this is distinct. These two subclasses are very distinct from other subclasses of Arachnida. So that is a systematic position. So to the further explain the difference between Acari, this is a picture of, it is a generalized Acari. This is a mite, not a tick, it's a mite. And I told you they have an anterior region as well as a posterior region of the body. Similarly, Araneae also, this is the body. This picture shows the body organization of Araneae, the spiders. The anterior region and the posterior region. Let us now see how subclass Acari differ from subclass Araneae. They both belong to the class Arachnida and they both are very relative. We call, spiders are the closest cousins of Acari. They are called as closest, not sisters, cousins of Acari, because they both have very distinct characteristic feature of improper segmentation or indistinct somatic segmentation. However, they also differ considerably. Let us see what are the difference. So this table will show you how Araneae, that is spider, differ from Acari. Both are subclasses. First difference is in their tagmosis or body division. You know, tagmosis is the division of body region into functional areas or functional regions. So in araneae or in spiders, the body is divided into anterior cephalothorax and posterior abdomen. And the two regions are connected by a very narrow pedicel. While in acarae, the body, I'll show you the picture later, the body region or the body is divided into two regions, anterior natosoma and posterior idiosoma. What about the mouth parts in araneae? Both of them, I told you, they belong to the subclass, subphylum Chelicerata. Is it not? Phylum Arthropoda, subphylum Chelicerata, and both of them will have Chelicerate type of mouth parts. And here, in araneae or in spiders, the mouth parts are inserted anteriorly on the cephalothorax. While in acarae, the mouth parts are enclosed or within, contained in the natosoma. Okay, then the third difference is in the leg. The position of the leg, both of them are having generally, you know, exceptions are there, four pairs of legs. But the position of the leg, where are they attached to the body? In the case of spiders or araneae, legs are borne or attached on cephalothorax. Cephalothorax means what? Anterior region where head plus thorax. Cephalum means head. Head plus thorax. So the legs are present on the cephalothorax. While in acarae, legs are inserted on the posterior region of the body. I told you natosoma and idiosoma are the two body regions, and legs are inserted in the idiosoma, that too on the anterior region of the idiosoma, where all the four pairs of legs are present, and that particular region of idiosoma where the legs are present is referred as podosoma. Podo means, or podo or poda means leg. Soma means body region. So in this picture, we'll go back and see. Here, this is the natosoma, anterior region where mouth parts are enclosed. It is inside. You can see, you know, this go inside. This is a sensory structure. This is actual Chelicera, feeding organ. It sometimes is inside this. This is a natosoma. It's like a cavity, you know, it's like a tunnel or something, like a cylindrical part. And this can go inside and outside. It can come and out. So four pairs of legs. See this region of the body, anterior region where all the four pairs of, from here to here, this region is podosoma. Whereas in araneae, this is cephalothorax, this is abdomen, and all the four pairs of legs are present on the cephalothorax. These are all palp, not leg. This is not leg. So both of them have four pairs of legs. So now you know that acarae differs from araneae. Araneae includes spiders. So we are not interested in araneae, because in acarology, araneae will not come. Spiders will not come. Anyway, spiders are the closest cousins of ticks and mites. So we just differentiated them. That is all. Next of interest, our interest is of acarae. And I told you, acarae includes both ticks and mites. However, ticks and mites also do differ from each other. Though they belong to the subclass acarae, they differ from each other. Ticks belong to the superorder Parasitiformes, while mite belongs to the superorder Acariformes. That is the two broad classification of subclass acarae. Subclass acarae is divided into two superorders. Ticks are included in Parasitiformes, while majority of the mites are included in Acariformes. But there is also one group of mite belonging to order Mesostigmata in Parasitiformes. Anyway, if you talk about ticks, we can say that they belong to the superorder Parasitiformes. And what is the economic importance of ticks, dear students? They are all bloodsuckers. Okay, students, we'll continue. Rose is in, I hope. So we'll continue with this introductory aspect of acarology. I told you acari includes both ticks and mites, and I told you the subclass acari is the closest cousins. Members of subclass acari are the closest cousins of subclass araneae, which includes spiders. And the ticks, you know, this is a tick. You can see it is also having four pairs of, almost like a mite, Nathosoma, Idiosoma, all those are there. Nathosoma, very small. But the ticks are all blood suckers. They are parasites, ectoparasites of mammals, including mammals and even some other vertebrates, including human beings. While mites, you know, they vary in their habits. Some of them are phytophagous, some predators, etc. In this picture, I have included my phytophagous mite family, spider mite family, no, which belongs to the family Tetranychidae. Anyway, you'll learn it more in the coming slides and coming classes. So you know, ticks and mites are included in subclass Acari. They again do differ because in our as far as we are students of agriculture and in discipline of agricultural entomology, we'll be dealing with mites. Because mites are of economic importance to agriculture. Ticks, are dealt in veterinary entomology. They teach ticks about ticks and other ectoparasites. Anyway, you should be able to differentiate a tick from a mite. Let us see the characteristics we use to differentiate ticks from mites. We use the body size, the body texture, the position of stigmata. This word is new to you, I hope. Stigmata is nothing. It is a respiratory opening. So what is a respiratory opening in insecta? It is spiracle. Yeah, the stigmata is equivalent to spiracle. Then next comes specialized sensory structure, whether present or absent. That is another character we use to differentiate ticks and mites. Then the nature of hypostome. Hypostome is what? Is the ventral aspect of Nathosoma. Nathosoma is the anterior part of the body region, and on the ventral side of it, we have the hypostome. Then the habit. Habit means what? Not habitat, habit. What do they feed? How do they live? That is all habit. So let us differentiate. Ticks are usually larger than mites, while mites are relatively smaller. And if you look into the body texture of ticks, you can see they are hard-bodied and leathery textured. That is what, in this picture itself, you can feel that, is it not? They're somewhat leathery texture, whereas they're soft-bodied. And position of stigmata, that is very important. If you see, most of the classification, insect mite classification into orders and suborders are based on the position of stigmata. For example, we use the terms prostigmata, mesostigmata, metastigmata, astigmata, etc. as groups or as taxa. So they are classified. This character is very important in taxonomy for classifying mites and ticks or subclass Acari. In the case of ticks, the stigmata is behind the fourth leg. Fourth coxa means coxa is the basal segment of leg in insects. In mites also, coxa. Same kind of segmentation you find in mite and tick leg also. So the stigmata or the respiratory opening is placed behind the fourth leg or behind the position of fourth coxa. One pair you can find in ticks. In mites, it will be placed anywhere on the idiosoma. The idiosoma is the posterior region of the body where leg is also placed. It can be anywhere, but it will be never behind the fourth coxa. It will be anterior to fourth coxa. It may be between the third and fourth coxa, or it may be at the position of first coxa, or even it may be above the first coxa, but never behind the fourth coxa. Next character is presence of specialized sensory structure. Only ticks has got a specialized, very specialized sensory structure called Haller's organ. I will show you the picture in the coming slide. Haller's organ is a very specialized sensory organ present on the foreleg of the tick, first pair of leg. Like in insect, we call it foreleg. Because I told you, they are all ectoparasites. So to attach or to find a host, they need to sense the temperature of the body temperature of mammal, of the host, as well as the smell of the blood. For that, they have a group of sensory organs in, present in a Haller's organ. Okay, sensory structures present in a Haller's organ. It's a cavity. Cavity with a lot of specialized sensory hairs on the foreleg. But in mites, no, they don't have such sensory organs. They have several sensory setae throughout the body, on the leg, on the palp, etc. But they don't have this Haller's organ as such. Then the nature of hypostome. Hypostome is the ventral aspect of nathosoma, which is the anterior region of the body where mouth parts are located. In the case of tick, on the ventral side of the nathosoma, they have recurved teeth. Recurved teeth means hook-like. Recurved, tip is curved. Recurved, why that? They use that to attach themselves to the body of the mammal. Most of the mammals have elastic skin, is it not? So they have to attach, they are ectoparasites. So that recurved series of teeth they have. Series of teeth are used to attach themselves on the host body. That such type of recurved teeth is absent on the hypostome of mites. Coming to the habit, I told you already that ticks are all, you know, blood suckers or blood sucking parasites of higher animals. Okay, maybe vertebrates. Majority of them are vertebrate, on vertebrates. So they are all blood suckers. But mites, they have diverse habit. They are phytophagous, they are predaceous, they are parasitic, they are saprophagous, detritivorous, fungivorous, so many diverse habits they have. So this is the difference between ticks and mites. And from now onwards, we'll not bother, but I'll show you the picture of ticks. Otherwise, we'll not bother about ticks because it is beyond the scope of agricultural ecology, right? So we'll be dealing only on mites. So this is a diagram of a tick. You know, you can see four pairs of legs. And actually, this is an anterior nathosoma region. Actually, this is the dorsal. This is the ventral aspect, not dorsal. This is the ventral aspect of the body. This is the stigmata. You can see stigmata is placed. This is coxa 1, coxa 2, leg 1, leg 2, leg 3, leg 4. Basal segment is coxa 1, 2, 3, 4. Anyway, stigmata is placed here behind. And on the foreleg, you have a small Haller's organ. And I have enlarged Haller's organ. See this type of organ, and inside there are so many specialized setae. It is not enlarged further. Anyway, you know, they have this, and they use this leg as sensory organ. They don't have antennas, is it not? Ticks and mites do not have antennas. So often the first pair of leg is antenniform. They use it like antenna to sense and all. So this is about a tick. Okay, so just you got an idea about what is acari, what are the relatives, more closest relatives of acari, and how acari differs from Araneae the spiders, and what all are included under acari, the ticks and mites, and how ticks differ from mites. Now on, I told you we'll be concentrating more of mites, and in this chapter about importance of acari, most importance, most of the importance is with reference to mites. One or two may refer to ticks. Okay, how are they important to agriculture, or as students of agriculture, or as scientists, or in the field of agricultural entomology or plant protection, or whatever it is? How mites, why should we learn acarology? That is what, or of mites. First thing is that, you see, they are very abundant. They are one of the most abundant arthropods in the soil, and they help in decomposing or degrading organic matter, and thereby, they help in nutrient cycling in terrestrial habitat where they are very abundant. They help in breaking down of organic matter, and this nutrient cycling is favored by them. That is the first foremost, very abundant creature in soil. So they can convert, and in this context, I will tell you the one term, auriculture. You must have heard the word. It's out of your syllabus. Still, I'll just give a mention. Auriculture, you know, vermiculture is culturing worms. Auriculture means there is one group of soil mites called Auribatida. And so Auribatida is the suborder. And there are family also called Auribatidae. And this Auribatid mites are, some of them are utilized even commercially also composting. For composting, they use, and one of the studies also in soil science, sometime back, there was a thesis on auriculture using Auribatid mite. I was also a part of it. And another thing is that most of the work in auriculture or about auribatic mites and their significance in composting is studied by Dr. M. A. Huck, who is a retired acarologist from Calicut University. He's still very active, retired maybe some 18 years back, maybe from, but still he visits the zoology department, and he's also a good guide for me. I used to contact him for further. He came here also 2-3 times, and he gave a lecture also sometime back. Okay. Then their next importance is that they are crop pests. See, they are crop pests. Many of them, the insects, I told you the mites are very diverse and they have so many families, orders, etc. Though only very, we can say that only 5 families of mites are phytophagous. But still, they are serious pests of economically important crops like vegetables, ornamental plants, fruit crops, spices and plantation crops. You can think of tea mites, very serious pest of tea. Hariconut, very serious pest. Coconut mite, very serious. Most of the ornamental plants, they are affected by mites. So they are serious pests and they cause economic damage to our crops. Okay, they cause direct damage to our crops. And some of the common phytophagous mite or pestiferous mites are, common names only I've given, the families I'll tell you later. Spider mites, Tetranychidae family. Flat mite, they are Tenupalpidae. Yellow mite, they belong to the family Tarsonimidae. Peacock mite, very less common in our area. Peacock like feathers, feather like parts they have, they have feathers, large number of feathers on their body, hence they are referred as peacock mite. They belong to the family Tuckerellidae. Unfortunately, I have not collected even a single Tuckerellid mite in the last 11 years of my acarology experience. Gall mite or bud mite, they are vermiform mites. No, but my vermiform mites, very small size mites, they belong to the family Areophidae. All of you know Areophidae because you know Areophid mite. Aseria gerironis is a serious pest of coconut. And gall mites and bud mites are all erinium mites. Sometimes we call them erinium mite or all these belong to the family Areophidae. Okay. Not only they attack crop in the field, they also attack stored products in the storage, in godowns, stored grains, as well as processed food materials. They attack and destroy, and they cause loss, economic loss to stored products and processed food. Not only they cause direct injury, they also cause indirect injury by contaminating the food with its body parts and shed skin and other things. Okay, so they are serious pest of most of the stored grain mites belong to the family Acaridae. I forgot to include this here example. Acaridae. One second, I may include it. Okay. So majority of them in the storage structure, we find acarid mites, and they are serious pest of stored grains. And the next importance is that some of the mites are vectors of plant diseases. They transmit certain diseases in our plants, not only, so that is an indirect damage caused by mites to crop plants. And most of these vector mites belong to the family Areophidae, though one or two other families like Tetranychidae, Tenupalpidae, one or two examples are there only in that, but most of them belong to the family Areophidae. And one most striking and very important example of this is pigeon pea sterility mosaic disease transmitted by the mite Aseria cajani. See, cajani. Aseria cajanus cajani, red gram. It is a serious pest of pigeon pea or red gram, and it causes sterility in plants, so that the crop loss is complete or total. So it is a highly economically important pest, Aseria cajani. So we have several other vectors of plant diseases in among the family Areophidae and few among the family Tetranychidae. So that way they are very important. Another importance of Acari is that they are vectors. Yeah, next is very important. Some of them are beneficial too. You know, some of the Acari or mites are highly beneficial because we have several families of predatory mites. Several families, when you survey or go out to the field and collect mite affected leaves and come back to the lab and observe them under microscope, we see a number of predatory mites associated with that. They belong to several families, many families, like Calyptidae. That family is, I'll tell you later, Calyptidae, Vidalidae, Cunaxidae, then Tididae, Stigmaidae, etc. But this family is very important, Phytosidae, because this is one family which includes economically important predatory mites. That is, the mite species which are exploited in biological control of phytophagous mites. And some of them are also utilized in the biocontrol of thrips, aphids, etc. And one striking example in this Phytosidae is the species Neocoelus longispinosus. Neocoelus longispinosus is a native to India, China, tropical. It is tropical, very abundant. It is native to our country, and we collect them often. We maintaining the culture. A lot of studies are being undertaken at our department, entomology department, in this organism. And we have also standardized technology to release Neocoelus in polyhouses. We have not conducted any study. One PhD thesis also was done in this aspect. A lot of the studies in Neocoelus are being taken up by acarology laboratories in India and elsewhere. Okay, several other species of Phytosidae are also the Amblyoscus and other things. Phytosoelus persimilis is again very important predatory mite of apple, of apple red mite, apple mite. So all these things are there. I've included only these important examples only. Okay, next is, yeah, again they are harmful sometimes, no? They are parasites of honeybees, brood parasite of honeybees. Some of the mites are serious of honeybees, and they destroy the bee colony, beehives, their brood, the grub are affected by these mites. And three important mites which are parasitic on honeybee are the ectoparasites Varroa jacobsoni and Tropilaelaps clariae. They are ectoparasites, while Acarapis woody is the tracheal mite. It's an endoparasitic mite. It invades inside. It lives inside the tracheal system, and it blocks the trachea, respiration, and all is affected. So three species of bee parasitic mites are included here, in that Varroa jacobsoni and Tropilaelaps clariae are ectoparasites, while Acarapis woody, that is an endoparasite, it infests tracheal system, tracheal mite. Okay, and if you go into mushroom house, I'm sure that you will collect a lot of mites. So they are pests of mushrooms. So very small ones causing decay and browning, necrosis, and all of the mushrooms. So they are serious pests in mushroom houses. You can collect large number in them and study. So they are serious pests. You need to manage them and all. Okay, another importance of acari. Why should we learn acari or acarology is important in agriculture is that there are a lot of mite species which actually destroy our insect culture in laboratories, in students' cultures, not only in student culture in experiments, but also in biocontrol laboratories. Think, if biocontrol laboratory, they rear large number of Corsaira. They need the Corsaira egg to mass multiply Trichogramma species, is it not? So all the cultures are contaminated and destroyed by several species of parasitic mite as well as predatory mites. So that way, we have to identify them in the early stage. We have to manage them. So that way, acari is very important. So Corsaira culture is very badly sometimes affected. Another aspect is again, very important. Some of them are associated with allergy in human beings, respiratory as well as skin allergy. Some people report respiratory and skin allergy, and doctors, dermatologists, if you consult a dermatologist, they will ask you several questions about your bed, how often do you clean your bed sheet or your carpet, your sofa or your bed sheet, all those things. So, the house dust mites, particularly the species Dermatophagoides farinae, I forgot to italicize this, as well as Dermatophagoides tiro, P is silent, tiro nisinus. These are the two common species of house dust mites, which are very common indoors, even in the bed. They feed, we shed a lot of skin daily. We do not know. We shed, every human being will shed skin cells, dead cells, it is shed. So these mites will live among them and they feed on that, those dead. And also not only that, and the fungus will grow on this dead skin, shed skin, and those fungus will be fed by these mites, and the excrement consists of volatiles which are actually causing respiratory as well as skin irritation on human beings. So this is one aspect. And certain, I know a person's name, I forgot, one person in Bangalore who is a doctor, dermatologist, exclusively, you know, researching and dealing with this aspects of acarology or dermatology, Dermatophagoides farinae. This is what he works on. Not only that, you know, they are also, you know, important parasites of poultry. They devastate sometimes the poultry houses, the hatchery and all, and they are parasites of poultry. The species Dermanisinus gallinae. See, Dermanisinus gallinae is an important species of poultry parasitic mite. So they, you know, the number of eggs laid is very much reduced if the poultry birds or hen and birds are affected by Dermanisinus gallinae. So that is all. They are important in veterinary also. Okay, in poultry science also. Not only in that, in livestock also. Not only that, they are also parasitic on our other domestic and pet animals. So the cold, the dog, cat, and other pet animals of ours are sometimes affected by certain mites called Sarcoptes cabi, Sauroptes equi, which will cause mangy. You know, mangy is something like a sore on the skin. Many a times you see certain dogs which are unattended, the street dogs, bleeding and with the wet wounds, is it not? With wounds on their body, with all sorts of reddish wounds. That is actually most often that is associated with the parasitic mite, Sarcoptes cabi, as well as Sauroptes equi. And they causes mangy disease on domestic and pet animals. And this mite can also infect human beings, can also infest human beings, attack human beings. Sarcoptes cabi, it can cause cabies on our skin also sometimes. You know, some human beings. Apart from that, there are certain parasites of human beings, mite parasites of human beings. One I told you, it is Sarcoptes cabi. Another one is very common among all of us, even if you just try and just scrub our forehead. You know, I had experienced that. Scrub our forehead, you know, near our, our forehead, near our hair. And just play some, whatever you get, you know, the skin, part of the skin and other thing, you place on a slide and observe under microscope. Most often you'll get a very elongate mite, called human follicle mite. Human follicle mite with short legs. They are throughout the world, and you can see this mite associated with human beings. So, but they will not cause much harm, except in certain situations, no, they can cause irritation, skin allergy, some scratching and other irritation of the skin and all. Okay, this is what I want to deal in the importance of a carry. However, I will also include one tick. Any of you heard of monkey fever? Anybody from Wayanad? Monkey fever, no, in Malayalam we call it kurang pani. It is reported from, a problem in tribal areas. Where tribals, when they go deep into forest, they get contracted with this disease. So, there is a tick. Okay, the tick which causes Kaisana, it is called as forest disease. I forgot to add that. Forest disease. The tick response, tick causing Kaisana forest disease interior or tribal areas where monkeys are the carriers is Hematophagoides. Hemophysalis farinae. Hemophysalis farinae is response is a tick which is responsible for transmitting Kaisana forest disease to human beings also. So this is a very, very, very dangerous disease. And sometime if you go to Wayanad and other park and other Wayanad, I know we have certain sanctuaries and other things, where they display a board, be careful, don't play with monkeys. That is a kind of display they keep. So that way, this tick is also important. So many importance are there, but I have not included tick except for this particular thing. So this is the importance of a carry. Before going into the next session, will be the morphology of acari, particularly mites. Before that, let us have a quick look at the brief history of acarology, how the science of acarology came into being. In modern science, no, acarology is considered as a discipline, as a very important discipline. How this came? If you look back into the history, you can see that the oldest known land arthropod recorded is from the late dates back to the late Denovian period, and this gives us the idea or information that mites and ticks have inhabited on Earth 350 million years ago. Compared to human beings, how many million years? 1 to 2 million years of human beings, existence of human beings on Earth. So like insects, no, they have also originated on Earth long back. However, the science of acarology, science of acarology or modern science of acarology, it emerged in Europe, in 18th century in Europe as a science, a modern science. Acarology emerged in Europe in the 18th century. And if you look back at the references of ticks and mites or acari, it is in 1550 BC, we find the oldest report of a tick in the Egyptian papyrus. You know, papyrus is a paper, a small book with the leaf, you know, palm leaves and all. They use palm leaf to write. In Egyptian papyrus, you can see references about tick. That is in 1550. Later, in 850 BC, Homer is a biologist, like you are an Aristotle. He's also a biologist, but he several centuries before he lived, or his period was. And he mentioned about ticks on a dog, on ticks attacking dogs. So they were aware of tick parasites on pet animals. Okay, and it was in 350 BC, Aristotle in his book, he referred or he recorded mites on cheese. You know, cheese mites are considered in France and all, they use actually cheese mites. They let mites into cheese to give added flavor to cheese in cheese industry. So cheese mites were first recorded by Aristotle in 350 BC. And 500 years after Aristotle, later, a mite which is parasitic on locust, locusts are nowadays, all of you are aware of locusts and all those things. And a mite which is parasitic on locust was reported in a animal zoology book. We can call it actually a zoology book or a compendium of materials. De Animalibus Histori Libri, not written in English. That is why it is italicized. So all these were known in earlier itself. Even the writings of philosophers like Hippocrates, Aristophanes, all their writings are there. Some of their writings find references to ticks and mites also. So that we can understand that ticks and mites were known long back to scientists. And Aristotle, coming back to Aristotle, you can say Aristotle was the first person who used the term acari. I told you, the Greek term acari for ticks. Actually, he used first that for ticks. And later, in 1650, very popularly, this acari has become very common in literatures, in zoology literatures or literatures regarding arthropods. And also, in early 20th century, acarology came as a modern science, as a separate discipline from zoology. It was separated, and 18th century onwards, acarology has got a separate status of a science, a separate discipline. It was a status of acarology itself as a separate discipline emerged during early 20th century. And if you see, which was the first mite, though mites were reported earlier by Aristotle in 350 BC and all, which was the first mite group which was described and named scientifically? It was Linnaeus again. Linnaeus' first edition of Systema Naturae, published in 1735. Whoa, my mistake, I wrote it. Yeah. in 1735, in his edition, he mentioned the mite genus Acarus. Later, by his 10th edition, you know, 10th edition has got a lot of significance, is it not? It is in this edition, you know, Linnaeus proposed hierarchical system of classification. That is one thing in the history of taxonomy. If you again go back to your first year lecture, it is the starting date of binomial nomenclature. Is it not? 1-1-1758. Also, in this edition, Linnaeus described 30 species of mites under the genus Acarus. He had only one genus, but 30 species. Later, so many people re-described under several, it was separated under several genera. Anyway, Linnaeus, see what all he worked on, not only insects, mites, and several other arthropods. So we are looking into the history. We'll go further. And in Europe and North America, the science flourished later. That means in several universities and institutes, they started teaching acarology as a discipline. That is what in Europe, in several universities in Europe, North America, several scientists started researching on mites, ticks. Several students also, they guide on acarology. That is what is modern science. That is how we say that is modern science. People started researching, and top universities started offering courses in acarology, all those things. And some of the well-known acarologists during those period, 19th to 20th century, if you see, are Grandjean, Cramer, Canestrini, Banks, Reuter, at least one or two you can remember. And if you don't remember, no problem, but still, these people are revered, and we remember them for their contributions in mite systematics as well as classification. That is, they do taxonomy. So they were all classifying, describing, and naming several species of mites. So these were the persons who worked on acarology or mites and ticks during 19th and 20th, between this period. And after World War II, you know, the condition was so untidy and other things, they started studying on scientists started studying on mite transmitted diseases, particularly the scrub typhus, which is a tick-borne fever, hemorrhagic fever. So scrub typhus was studied. So that during that time, several universities set up facilities in their laboratory to study on ticks and mites. Okay, after World War II. And in 1952, a good monumental work was published by Baker and Wharton. No, they are now no more, but they were very, very prominent, eminent acarologists, I would say. They published the book, An Introduction to Acarology, in 1952. Still now people refer that book, and they are considered, both of them, they're not a single father, but fathers of acarology, they are considered as modern acarology. Okay, so Baker's and Wharton's books we always rever and remember. Then, V. Prasad, though he is an Indian based in, I think he is basically a Bengali or so, or from Gujarat, I don't remember exactly, Gujarat, yes. But he shifted in his early school days itself in US, and he worked with several universities like Ohio State Universities and Michigan State, several other universities of US, and he has contributed a lot to the science of acarology, and his book, History of Acarology, published in 1982, is considered as a monumental work and a very elaborate work on the history of acarology in the world, starting from the Vedic period starting from the papyrus work, Egyptian papyrus, starting from that. So sometimes we refer this also. And if you look into some of the eminent acarologists in India, particularly in South India also, and and some of the eminent acarologists, this name, G.P. Chandabasavanna, is no more. He is from University of Agricultural Sciences, Bangalore. He was a pioneer actually in India to work on, in India, if you say, to work on mites, it was Chandabasavanna. And several of his students were trained, and he still trained several students and guided several students in acarology. Then Dr. Mohana Sundaram himself got guided under Chandabasavanna, but now he's 85 plus, I think he's still, sometime back, for maybe 2 years back also, we met him in conferences, but now he sits at home, he's weak, and he has guided several other people at TNAU. He's based at TNAU. B.S. Chillar, know his book. I refer Chilla's book. He is at Punjab Agricultural University, Chilla. And S.K. Gupta is still there. He also visited our university, our lab. S.K. Gupta, we visit. Used to meet him often. Acarologists, when we have meeting. S.K. Gupta is a Bengali based at. He worked several years for Zoological Survey of India, and he has several books and several papers to his credit. He is still active acarologist, though he is 80 plus. M.S. Dhuria, Dhuria is Punjab, again from Punjab. Punjab Agricultural University, retired. His book is, I'm referring actually his book on fundamentals of acarology, very good book. Then B. Malik, retired from University of Agricultural Sciences, Bangalore, a student of Channabasavanna. R. Ramaraju is still, not yet my teacher at TNAU, entomology teacher. He's also an acarologist trained under Channabasavanna. Has a lot of students he guided on acarology. M.A. Huck, he is an acarologist from Calicut University. He is the one I told you, a specialist on horticulture, Mohammed Huck. I also used to have a close association with him. And his student, N. Ramani, madam, has just retired. They are all great, great acarologists with a lot of contributions to acarology. And I think that is about the history of acarology. That is about history and the introductory part. Next chapter, straight away move on to morphology. Carrie, any doubts or something? I have a 2 minutes break. 2 minutes break. So we'll have just 2 minutes break to have some water. That's all.